हेलो फ्रेंड्स, नमस्ते एवरीवन। टुडे वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट जैक केरोयाक्स नोबेल द धर्म बॉम्ब्स एंड वी विल नो अबाउट बीट जनरेशन, बीट कल्चर एंड द नॉर्म्स एंड वैल्यूज ऑफ बीट जनरेशंस। सो लेट्स स्टार्ट आवर प्रेजेंटेशन। सो फ्रेंड्स, एज यू कैन सी ऑन माय स्क्रीन, we'll start from here. Look at this picture, friend. This picture is of Caroline Cassady, who was wife of Neil Cassady and who was very close friend of Jack Kerouac. So she was, as you can see, she was very beautiful, and Jack Kerouac and she had good relationship. So to attract your attention, I have just brought the picture here. Okay, let's move ahead, friends. The Dharma Bombs. It's a novel by Jack Kerouac, as I have already said. And so, before we break into the beat culture, we have to know some of the facts on the history of beat culture and how beat culture started and what were the socio-cultural contexts that actually saved beat generation. Okay, now, so to know about beat culture, we have to know about behavioral rules of the 1950s of America. So what was the behavioral rules? There was the system of conformity. It means that everyone should obey the authority. Everyone must follow the authority. During 1950s, so it was the era of consumer culture, and it was the era of television, and people, they had to follow the authoritarian rules. They had to follow the government laws. So the behavioral rules are the popular rules of the 1950s. Well, to obey the authority and to control one's emotions and do not make waves, and they had to fit in the group and not to think even about sex. So what was the rule? Was they had to, or people during that age, they had to go, they had to follow, they had to obey the rules. They were not allowed to go out of the authority. They were not allowed to challenge the authority. They were not allowed to criticize the authority. So they had to live very kind of pure life. They had to control their emotions. So that were the some of the characteristics of conformity era. Now let's move ahead. Okay, then how it started? During 1950s in America, that was also the time of rock and roll. So it was believed to make teenagers behave inappropriately. And now rock and roll started slowly, and then you can see it in the picture, the Beatles, and that band also got popular, and still people listen Beatles music and John Lennon, then Harris Morrison. So there were four people. Now let's move ahead. So that was era of delinquency. Era of delinquency means that was era of crime, era of juvenile delinquency. Youths, they used to try different kind of sporting kind of thrilling kind of challenges. As you can, if you see, if you watch movies like The Wild One or the Rebel Without the Cause, fantastic movie. I also watched that movie. And if you read novel, a very famous novel, The Catcher in the Rye by J.D. Salinger, you will find these kind of norms. The youths were troubled youths. They tried to break the authority. They tried to break the kind of so regular social rules. They tried to come up with some kind of thrilling kind of ideas. try to oppose the establishment, those kind of sensations were there. Okay, friends, let's move ahead. Then now the finally came the non-conformists. As we have already known, 1950 was the era of conformist. People had to conform, people had to go with the waves. Now finally came the those group or those kind of sentiments started to arise, which we call it the non-conformists. So now that non-conformists were actually those people who established or who incepted beat generation. So one of the prominent writer or figure of that era who coined this term was Jack Kerouac, and his most popular novel was On the Road. And mind is the photo which I show you in the beginning. It means Caroline Cassidy. She wrote the novel Off the Road. Look, they were close friends. Jack Kerouac's novel On the Road and Caroline's novel Off the Road. So this is a kind of similarity and coincidence. So there were other popular writers as well who belong to beat generation, and they wrote about not conforming to society's mores. They wrote about not conforming to authorities. They wrote about not conforming to established or dominating kind of rules, laws. And then they found a strong following in teenagers. Actually, they inspired teenagers. They motivated teenagers, and teenagers were hugely motivated by those kind of sentiments, those kind of culture. Okay, let's move ahead. So historically, it starts with Jack Kerouac. When we talk about beat culture, we have to know that founding figure, Jack Kerouac. Actually, he was not the only one. He was also inspired by the poet and writer like Walt Whitman and Ernest Hemingway. But the core kind of beat generation, beat culture started with these kind of people like Jack Kerouac, Allen Ginsberg, and Neil Cassidy, and we will know about others. So he was born in 1922 and he died in 1969. As you can see in the picture, he is holding a bottle of alcohol, and the picture says much about him that he was an alcoholic person, and he used to meditate with that kind of experiments, new kind of experiments. He wrote about that against materialistic society. He wrote about that kind of peace, kind of solitary time we everyone needs in life. So against materialism, against consumer culture, he was a revolutionary writer. He was born in Lowell, Massachusetts in 1922. His parents were French Canadian. Then they migrated, and he belonged to North Carolina. And if you read Thermobombs, you will find a good journey about him. He was educated at Columbia University. Then at the end of Second World War, he began traveling across the United States to Mexico, to different states of United States, and then he has written all about his journeys, encounters, encounters with people of different culture, different thoughts, different jobs. And so if you read the Dharma poems, and if you read, you must have to read first On the Road. If you have planned to read the Dharma poems, the first part is unofficially, the first part becomes On the Road. So you have to read On the Road, then you have to read the Dharma poems. Okay. So the term beat generation, it was invented by Jack Kerouac, as we have already discussed, in 1948. So it was introduced to the public by an article on New York Times magazine. So beat, actually the literal meaning of beat means tide, reaction against capitalism. So now connotative meaning goes like reaction against capitalism and Puritan middle class values, which believes that people should have a kind of serene life, pure life. People should not revolt against religion. People should live very humble life. People should have very disciplined life defined by traditions, classic traditions. So then it again what modified, the beat term was modified to beatific, and it denotes Kerouac's reverence for certain aspects of Catholicism and Buddhism. Kerouac, again and again, he wrote about, he incorporated, let's say, Buddhist notion and Christian notions in his writing. He was neither anti-Christian, he was neither in favor of Buddhism, but he tried to see the path of solitude, he tried to see the path of satisfaction, he tried to see the path of self-spirited freedom through the incorporation of Buddhist notions, Jain notions in his writing. So if you read his writings, you will not find that he is against Christianism and he is advocating for Buddhism, or he has something very fond with Buddhism only, going against his own religion. It's not so. He was just trying to see the world from a kind of humanistic perspective. That was the reason. So friends, let's move ahead. So prominent beat writers. Who were prominent beat writers? Jack Kerouac, Allen Ginsberg, William Burroughs, Gregory Corso, Neil Cassady, Gary Snyder, and now this Gary Snyder and Jack Kerouac's story is written in Dharma Bombs. So Jack Kerouac's name here, fictional name is Ray Smith, and Gary Snyder's name is Jeffy Ryder. So we'll discuss about them later on as well. Now Lawrence Ferlinghetti, they were some prominent beat writers. So you can see this picture. Now, so what was the beat rebel? Beat rebel, what was the beat, what was the rebel? What was the beat rebel now? It was a rejection of mainstream American values, experimentation with drugs and sexuality, and embraced Eastern spirituality. Look, it was an experimentation with drugs and sexuality. They experimented new kind of literature, new kind of values, new kind of ideas, new kind of philosophies with drugs and sexuality, and that was not mere for entertainment. Look, they were the philosophers of that level. Even we can't imagine that people, they experimented philosophy with drugs and sexuality. It's very hard for common people like us to think about experimentation, of philosophy with these kind of things. And it was an interest in Eastern spirituality. During that time, people were attracted, people were hugely inclined towards Eastern spirituality, like Jain philosophy, like Taoism, like other Buddhist notions. So it was again a rejection of mainstream American values. Now they went against American established values and they tried to find some kind of spiritual values in living. They tried to seek spiritual value in life. So we have to consider that they were not rebel with arms and ammunition. They were rebel with thoughts, they were rebel with spiritual mantras. They were beats. Just okay, friends, let's move ahead. Did they influence? Now the question comes. Of course, they influenced. Of course, their writing had influence. Spread of eco consciousness. They wrote about nature, they wrote about the beauty, they wrote about the transcendentality, they wrote about the spirituality of nature, environment around us. Attention to a second religiousness. Then their writing, what their writing was capturing attention of second religiousness. They wrote about Buddhism, which was not prime religion, which was not major religion in US. So their writing had respect for land and indigenous peoples and creatures. Look, of course they influenced. They were not someone who just enjoyed the drug, who just were escapist. They were not escapist. Actually, they were the silent philosophers. They were the silent rebels who actually supported these indigenous cultures, who actually supported new way of looking towards the world, who actually supported to preserve eco-consciousness, to preserve that ecology environment. Friends, so they were very important. Let's see how important they were. Okay, friends, so if you are more interested and if you want to enjoy beat culture through movies, of course there are hundreds and thousands of movies, and some movies worth to watch. You can see the French movies here, Sans Toit Ni Loi, and then Vagabond. It's translated in English, Vagabond, it means neither home nor shelter. So very fantastic movie. I have watched this movie. Please, I recommend you once to go through this movie. It's a marvelous movie, friend. Believe me, one of the most capturing movie. So next movie is Into the Wild. What to say about this, friend? One of the best movie. If you want to live that solitary life into the wild and how wild treats you, you have to watch. And these movies are based on real events and another very comic and a kind of satiric movies there, Cheese and Chunks of Happiness. You have to watch this movie, friends, believe me. So friends, let's move ahead now. So let's discuss the Dharma bombs. I have brought some reference here. According to Goodreads, it is rated 3.9 out of 5, and it was originally published in 1958, and its setting is in California, North Carolina, Washington, and elsewhere in the US, and setting goes from 1955 to 1956 journey up. Our writer Jack Kerouac, who is referred as Ray Smith. So major characters here are J.P. Ryder, Ray Smith, Alva, Morley, Princess, Rosie Buchanan, Chin Monahan, and others. And we will discuss about them later in the video. So major characters of Dharma Bums novel, Jack Kerouac as Ray Smith. You can see in the picture, Gary Schneider is presented as J.P. Ryder, and Ellen Ginsberg as Alva Goldberg, in whose house our character Ray Smith lived when he traveled from North Carolina to California, and his name is presented as Alva Goldberg in this novel, The Dharma Bonds. And actually, Ray Smith goes to meet one of his best friend, close friend, J.P. Ryder. J.P. Ryder, also a fog who used to, let's say, tree lumber man who used to cut trees, and who was a great admirer, reader of Buddhist philosophies. And at the end of the novel, this character, J.P. Ryder, leaves his place and goes to Japan to learn Buddhism and work there. And our Ray Smith and J.P. Ryder, they depart. That is the very tragic ending, friend, believe me. So J.P. Ryder and Ray Smith, this Dharma Bim is all about their friendship. Ray Smith travels from his home North Carolina to California to meet his friend J.P. Ryder, and they were common folks, friend, believe me. They used to buy clothes from second hand stores like the Salvation Camp, like other. So they used to work for small amount of money, and they used to live very humble life. They used to take drugs, they used to experiment with sexuality. They had a lot of girlfriends, but after all, they were interested in a kind of literature, philosophy that can reboot humanity, that can reboot spirituality, that can reboot man's friendship with man. Okay, friend, let's move ahead. So, Adventure of Ray Smith. When we start the novel, we have to first know the thing that our main character Ray Smith starts journey, his journey from this, look at North Carolina, from the right side of you or screen you can see, he starts all the way from North Carolina to California to meet his friend J.P. Ryder. So look at how long he travels. So what's Dharma Bombs all about? Dharma bomb etymologically he defines a spiritual beggar, someone who begs for spirituality, someone who begs for humanity. It's a story of friendship between J.P. Ryder and Ray Smith, and its accounts are like diary. It's like diary mentioning. First he goes there, then he goes there. So he wanders from North America across North America. It doesn't have any central plot. It doesn't have any major event. Every event is central event, friend. It doesn't mean that there is not event. Every event is central event. Episodic structure. It has episode upon episode, and it's based on theme of the journey, and it's escape from town life, from one's own past to the spirituality, to look how actually we have to live. So friends, please read this a must read novel. Some key features of experimental writing. What were the key features of experimental writing? They were spontaneous and episodic. They had natural explosion of feelings and thoughts, unsophisticated language, defined heap talk, unsophisticated language. They used to write with free thoughts, vital, authentic, alive and individual language. A kind of individual creativity could be seen in their writing. And it was opposite to conventional language. They didn't write in canonical language. They didn't write in very sophisticated language, academic language. Their writing was something new, and they broke the impersonality of the artist. So they came up with the something very impersonal thing in very impersonal way. Okay friends, let's move ahead. So spontaneous writing, this is example I have snipped here. You can see if you read novel, this paragraph gives you clear example of how spontaneous writing was one of the key method for our beat writers. Look, there is no full stop, and the huge long paragraph goes and goes, goes and goes, like thoughts in our mind goes. And African American writing, and that blend of African American writing in beat writers writing. So look at the way, look, supposing there is no G going, there is no G. So blend of African American writing can be found in beat writers writings. Look at, I have highlighted those words will qualify as African American writing. Okay, about his writing style now. I have snippet one interview where he says that he writes whatever keeps coming to his mind. He takes a long roll of paper, then he keeps on writing and writing. When one of the interview, Steve Allen asks him, so how do you write? Then he reveals about the technique of his writing. He says, look, when I write narrative novels, I don't want to change my narrative thought. I keep going. He doesn't edit. It means he keeps on going. Look at the kind of very real, very personal and very raw tone could be found in their writing. So a kind of authentic voice, friends. They were against the popular culture. Look, so their popular culture, as we have already discussed, the age was consumer culture age, the age was work, the age was people were working, they had a low income, and they were a kind of de-individualized. They had no time for solitary, they had no time to meditate, and they were like people were being converted into machines. So they were against this kind of popular culture behaviors. They avoided this kind of things. They resigned from this kind of things. They were against the system, friends. They were against the systems that control their freedom. They were against the system that control their thoughts. They were against the system that control people's individual creativity, people's individual criticism, people's individual let's say a kind of very creative thought. So they were against the system. against the dumb consumer culture. That was the age of dumb consumer culture, as we can see in 1950s, and even now, even in our country, we can see people blindly follow everything. People blindly follow the advertisements. People blindly follow the global capital culture values. They never question the goods. They never question technologies. They blindly follow the technologies. People have become a kind of hypnotized with media, kind of hypnotized with advertisements, a kind of hypnotized with technology. So they were actually, friends, this is what we actually need. We actually need to go against term consumer culture. We have to be very critical. We shouldn't buy, we shouldn't, let's assimilate whatever we get from the market product. We have to question. Now, critique of organized system come dominant culture. They were critique. I have learned, you said they were critique of organized system and dominant culture. They were against those dominant culture, and then they feel alienated from dominant culture. So they what? They criticize that dominant culture. They criticize the government. They criticize that government that only listen for business people. They criticize the government that which only listen for the tycoon class. So they criticize that kind of culture. They criticize the kind of capitalist society, friends. Okay, right against the mechanical consciousness. They were against the mechanical consciousness. We have to be creative consciousness. We have to be organic consciousness. So we have to have organic consciousness, not mechanical consciousness. Something our consciousness should not perform like something machine. It means very determined. We have to be very creative. We have to be very critical. So it was, they thought that it was a conspiracy to impose one level of mechanical consciousness on mankind existed. In what search for self-spirited freedom, friends, as we have already discussed, they wait for the sorts of new roots. They were for the source of new spirituality. They were source for new humanity. They were source for the definition of new kind of living. So pity and compassion, friends, as we read their writings, we can find pity and compassion. If you read Dharma Mums, I brought the reference here, and this line shows that actually Bridge Mason, actually Jack Kerouac's writings watch for the pity and compassion for those helpless people, poor people. So these are the bibliographies, friends. Okay, the mountain which he climbs in the middle of the story, when he first visits J.P. Ryder, his friends Ray Smith first visits J.P. Ryder, then they climb this mountain, and this mountain is Matterhorn, Sloan Peak, and it's located in north of Cascades of Washington State. And at the end, very nice, he spends, look, Jack Kerouac spends 63 days over this desolation peak. The name itself is no friends, desolation loop. Then he spends 63 days as a fire lookout during 1956 summer. Then a kind of what, he was desolated, he was alone, he was meditating on his own. So what? What's beat? Beat is not a journey, the beat is Christ, the beat is Ivan, the beat is any man who breaks this beat path to follow the destined path. If you are more interested in the beat, friends, you have a lot of novels written by different writers, so you can see on screen. So friends, I don't read beat, I am the beat. Thank you, friends, we'll meet.